them. They come every year in October, whether we want them or not. And we always want them, of course. They're such a blessing. All right. Well, it's so good to see every one of you. We're, of course, in the midst of our 50th year of our year of Jubilee. And I'm going to be speaking today about what that Jubilee is all about. So we look forward to that. All righty. Brother John's going to come, and he's going to lead our first song.
All right. Good morning, church family. Well, we have one song that we're going to sing three times in a row. All right. There's not four verses, five verses, just one. And I'm sure it'll be a blessing to you. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him, heaven, earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. Thank you. I know some of you are getting nervous. How high are we going to go? That's good. That's good. We should do that one time. Just keep on going up. All right. Thanks.
All righty. Let's wave to everybody and say, hey, how we doing? Good to see you. And we want to say hello to you that are online. Alrighty, let's ask the Lord's blessing, shall we? Father, thank you today for this beautiful day outside and a beautiful day inside as we have gathered together in your name, as we look at the Word of God, as we hear music, as we fellowship, as we just enjoy this part of this celebration month. I pray, Lord, it would be a blessing to all that are here today. We pray for those who are online, those who cannot be here, those who are sick, those who are still at home, Lord. We just pray your peace be upon each and every one. Help us, Lord, just to continue to navigate through the pandemic. Help us, Lord, to get to the point someday down the road when everybody comes back and we're all back together again, fellowshipping in church like it used to be. And until that time comes, I pray, Father, that you would just help us to be faithful and to still stay involved in our church and still ultimately worship you, Lord, in spirit and in truth. Thank you, Lord, for the McCluskeys and their ministry and their coming here today. I know, Lord, it's a big day whenever they're here because we just enjoy them and enjoy their ministry, and we just pray there'll be a blessing through the music, through the message, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. All righty, you may be seated this morning as you are. Let me give you just a couple announcements here today. Well, Wednesday night, make sure you come back, and we'll be looking at the life of David. Also, on this coming Wednesday, we have one of our missionaries that's going to be with us. Because of security reasons in the country that they're involved in, they cannot have their name publicized, or they cannot have anything on the internet. So I can tell you is that we do have a missionary family coming, and you'll have to come on Wednesday to hear them. And those who will be watching online, we're going to do our regular Bible study first, and then we'll have our missionary afterwards, so you won't actually be seeing that. But we do want to let you know that we do have one of our missionaries here on Wednesday night, so if you could be here in person, that would be better, if you want, especially if you want to see them, okay? So that is this coming Wednesday night. As we continue with our announcements here today, we want to also remind you that Awana has started back, and the kids are coming back to that. And, you know, we took about a year and a half off from the Awana program, and we're looking forward to the kids fulfilling that year now of the Awana program. Friday nights, our youth group are still going on, and we have our new youth directors here, and Justin and Caitlin doing a great job. Looking forward, we'll be talking a little bit more about them next week, give you an opportunity to get to meet them a little bit more in depth. And we're so excited about them being part of our ministry here for our kids. Alrighty, also want to remind you that next week is our ministry fair, and we did this back in August, and we showed you kind of different areas. I feel like we're kind of starting a church over again in some ways, you know, and, you know, we've lost some folks, and, you know, the folks that used to help out in various ministries are not here, or some have, you know, for one reason or another, not available. So we're trying to kind of get things back, and we have recouped a lot of what we used to do. But we still want to get you involved, and so next Sunday we're going to have a ministry fair, and we're going to explain it to you, and we're going to do kind of just a small luncheon next week. Now, we do have a big luncheon this week, so I want everybody to stay. Please don't go home. We have a lot of food, and it looks like not everybody came today, so that means you get to eat two and three times as much as you normally would. And so don't miss out on that. But next Sunday, we'll do the ministry fair and have a little luncheon after that. Well, speaking of today's luncheon, we're going to go into gym right after the morning service. We're going to enjoy a good time of fellowship, good meal. We have some new cooks all ready to go, and they're excited about preparing some good food for you. And then we're going to come back in here after we're done eating about 1:30, and McCluskey is going to come sing, and Brother Pat's going to bring us a message. And that'll take the place of our Sunday night service. So there is no evening service tonight, as we'll have the afternoon service in place of that. Alrighty, last Sunday, we gave out these sparkling new tumblers. How many have used your tumbler? All right, why haven't the rest of you used them yet? They do work. Put your coffee, your water, your soda, whatever else you want in there, and go ahead and use those. And they have a little treat inside. How many ate the treat inside? All right, oh, everybody eats a treat. All right. If you didn't get one last week, we have some available this week. So if you're a visitor, you're welcome to have one. If you weren't here last Sunday, make sure you get one. They are available on the back table. Also, last week we gave out our brochure that showed kind of the little history of the church, some pictures. This kind of shows you where we came from, how the buildings progressed, and just the ministries we've had over the years, and then, of course, just a picture of our staff on the back. So don't miss out on that. It's good to see Warren and Roberta in the back there. God bless you. Thanks for coming in. You're going to get a mug for coming today, okay? All righty. They live near Shady Maple, right around the corner from Shady Maple. So we're going to come up and see you someday soon, all right? We were there for Warren's 80th, right? Was it 80 or? Oh, okay. 85th. Yeah, I thought 80 was when you lived here, so 85th, all right? And we had a great time a few months ago. All right, but if you didn't get one of these, they are available on the back table likewise. All right, I'm done with all the announcements, all the commercials, everything is all done. And we are going to show you, before the McCluskeys come, every week we've been trying to show you some missionaries that we've supported over the years. They've sent us a little message about our anniversary, so we have a little presentation from a couple of our missionaries.
Happy 50th anniversary, Concord Baptist. When the Apostle Paul was writing his epistles, he wrote to the Church of Thessalonica, and he said, "We give thanks to God always for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience in hope of our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father." We pray the same thing for you and thank you for your work of labor in the last 50 years, always striving to share the gospel with whoever will listen.
It's great to look back and see the history of Concord Baptist and the outreach that you've had in the community, and then also how you've had the outreach around the world and touching so many lives. What a privilege to be a part of a church mindful of the global impact and that we're together working towards the kingdom of God. We hope you have another 50 years, that God will bless you and have his hand on you. And we will continually pray for you and look forward to what God's doing in the future.
Have a great anniversary celebration.
Okay. All right. Well, That's Neil and Cheryl Prentice, for those who weren't sure who they are. Missionaries, former missionaries in Mexico. Now they have a ministry based out of the States, and they are more into the mentoring and helping missionaries with various projects and how to get them to reach their people groups. So service today.
She pressed through the crowd, so weak and so frail. So often she'd reached out, but her efforts failed. With faith so persistent, determined, she must touch Jesus. Her friend said, just give up, for after 12 years of heartaches and failures, disappointments and fears, accept your condition with the multitude. He will not see us. I can hear her rejoicing as she looks down the lane. She sees someone coming. They're calling his name. Son of David, Messiah. She heard someone call him the healer. The crippled and lame were now leaping for joy. Those who were blind were beholding the Lord. Would this be the moment, or would hindrances many conceal her? Her heart beat so fast as he came into sight. Her emotions were filled with both joy and with fright. She let him pass by, but not out of reach. As she touched his garment, he turned to speak. Someone's been healed today. A miracle passed your way. Who touched my clothes? You now are made whole. Step forward and play. Jesus is passing your way.
God's sending witnesses, the impossible.
Sending down blessings each day. You can be healed today. You let a miracle pass your way. Reach out, touch his clothes. You can be made whole. Step forward and play. Your faith has pulled you through. Your healing will come to you. You can receive today, right now, in Jesus' name. You can receive today, right now.
Sing this song on the Sea of Galilee over in, where were we? Oh, we were over in the Holy Land. And it's a beautiful song, talks about the disciples worried, and Jesus steps forward and calms the sea. Listen to what it says.
Crossing the calm sea with Jesus, the disciples were getting concerned. The wind started violently blowing. He was asleep in the stern. Does he not care that we perish?
You glad you know the one that can raise the dead? Amen. You know, if you know Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you already got the victory. Hallelujah. A lot of people get calling me when I'm moving on down the highway driving that coach. And they say, how you doing? I say, man, I'm pushing diesel fuel and shout the victory. You know what I mean? Sometimes that's the case. Man, it's good to see you. It's good to be able to be here. I know that you've all prayed for the McCluskeys during our COVID spat. We had a little spat going on there with COVID. And it's funny because my wife, it was on the 4th of July, actually, and about 3 days later, my wife woke up that morning, and she looks at me, and I'm already kind of like, you know, hardly moving, you know. She looks at me, and she goes, I got COVID, and you gave me this. That's what she said. So I was kind of like, okay, whatever. I don't know what to tell you, you know. So anyway, but I appreciate you praying and bouncing back, thanking the Lord for victories in our life, and thank you for helping us a little bit financially. That was a major blessing. You have no idea. And y'all are pretty special to us. And it's great to see, of course, your pastor, Lois. We have known each other now for, oh, at least 20 years. I'm trying to make it shorter so we sound younger. You know what I'm saying? We've known each other now for over 40 years, I think it is. And it's just a joy. I think 1979, at the back, 79, 80, I think, were the years when we first met y'all. Can you believe that? And the church was started 50 years ago. I mean, think about that. 71, 79 is when we met. I mean, good night. We're getting up there. You know what I'm saying? But, man, hey, listen, I hope you'll stop by the CD table in the back. We've got some things back there. Hopefully it'll be a blessing to you. We've got CDs back there, a special on CDs right now. You buy the first CD, and we're going to give you another CD. You just have to pay an additional fee. That's what they say on television, and it sounds good, doesn't it? No, I hope you'll stop by there. We'll work something out. And then we've got T-shirts back there, Make America Christian Again, Keep America Christian. And we're supposed to get some new ones tomorrow that say Cancel Culture, and it's got a cross through it, and it says Christ Culture. Amen. And so I hope you'll just stop by and take a look. Shake hands with us. We've got some bracelets back there as well, and other bracelets that are there for donation basis. Now listen, we take Visa, MasterCard, now we're taking Bob Evans gift cards if you got them, amen. And a limited number back there. Once that limited number is gone, I'm going to have to walk out to the car and bring in another limited number. It's kind of the way it works, but anyway. Hey, I think we need to do a hand clapping song. This one's called He's the Foundation of My Salvation. So you got to go like this. Come on now, help me. Yeah, you got it. Help us wake up, amen.
From the beginning to the end, there's one Savior for all men. Jesus of Nazareth, Lord of Lords, our precious King. He is as gentle as a dove, full of mercy, grace, and love. Yet he's the tower of strength on which I can depend.
And he's the foundation.
He's the foundation. The answer for my needs. When I was steeped in sin, I looked at Calvary. There I saw Jesus reaching down, loosing the chains that had me bound. That old Satan had to lose his hold on me.
And he's the foundation.
He's the foundation
of my salvation.
My salvation.
He is the rock.
He is the rock.
I am following home.
I'm so
McCluskeys. We're going to hear from them in just a minute. We're going to take a break, though, take up our offering. So our men are going to come down and pass the plates. So be prepared to give in the offering. Now, we're going to take an offering for the McCluskeys at the end of the service. So you want to give accordingly. This is our regular church offering, and at the end will be for the McCluskeys. All right, as our men come down, we want to thank those who have been faithful to give tithes and offerings, missionary gifts. All these missionaries you're seeing throughout this month have been supported for many years by your faithful giving. And we want to thank each and every one of you, because without your gifts, you know, we don't keep on going on here, and some of our missionaries would be affected likewise. So we thank you for that. I'm going to ask Brother Jim Hill to lead us in a word of prayer for our offering, please.
Each day that I live, He gives more than I need. I could never describe His goodness to me.
You ask how I make it day after day. There's only one thing I can say. It's been a long journey, but I have been blessed. Walking with Jesus, I have no regrets. He is so good to me, I must confess. The way has been long, but I'm
when I'm hungry, He feeds me with manna so sweet. When my soul is weary, He gives peace and rest.
All I can say is I'm blessed.
Now I've had my share of sunshine and rain. Days filled with laughter, nights filled with pain. But with every mile as I travel this way,
the journey gets sweeter each day. He ran to me, took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, my son's come home again, lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, do you know I still love you?
He caught God ran
dusty road ahead I could see.
It was the only time,
the only time I ever saw him run, was when
he ran to me, took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said my son's come home again, and lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, do you know I still love you?
He caught me by surprise, and it brought me to my knees when God raised. I saw him run to me.
When God raised,
I was so ashamed,
so ashamed,
all alone and so far away. Now I know.
Now I know.
He's been waiting.
Said my son's come home again. He lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son, come home again. He ran to me, took me in his arms, held my head to his chest. Said my son's come home again. He lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes. With forgiveness in his voice, he said, son,
God called me son. He said,
son, do you know I still love you?
I'm so glad that I know the one who is the very cornerstone in my life, the very foundation of my salvation. We sang it a little bit earlier. This song is a beautiful song. Let him be your cornerstone. Amen.
Jesus is the cornerstone. Came for sin rejected by his own, he became the cornerstone. Jesus is the cornerstone.
When I am by sin oppressed, on that stone I am at rest.
When the seeds of truth are sown, he remains the cornerstone.
Jesus is the cornerstone.
For me,
of ages, so secure, for all time it shall endure, till its children reach their home. He remains the cornerstone.
Well, that was great. Thank you, Pat and Kyla McCluskey. We always enjoy your music, and so good to see Pat back in action again. They had to take a few months off, sick leave, and we prayed for him, and I was texting him all throughout the time, seeing how he was doing, and just so glad that they could be here. He's doing well. He's been off his oxygen for a while now. He had to be on oxygen for a while. He's been off that. And God's brought healing, and we're thankful for that. And God bless you. Thank you for being here today. Let's turn in our Bibles to Leviticus chapter 25 this morning. Leviticus, that's in the Old Testament. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, the third book, sorry, third book of the Bible. One of those books that we usually skip over. Has a lot of law in it, a lot of priests' garments and tabernacle and all these various things of the Old Testament law. And in chapter 25, though, we're going to read a passage of Scripture about the 50th year. The 50th year, the year of Jubilee. What is the year of Jubilee? That's what we're going to look at this morning. We've been talking about this Jubilee celebration. So let's go back to Scripture and see what it was all about. In Leviticus chapter 25, and the Lord spake unto Moses in Mount Sinai, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, when you come into the land which I give you, then shall the land keep a Sabbath unto the Lord. 6 years thou shalt sow thy field, and 6 years thou shalt prune thy vineyard and gather in the fruit thereof. But in the seventh year shall be a Sabbath of rest unto the land, a Sabbath for the Lord. Thou shalt neither sow thy field nor prune thy vineyard. Go down to verse number 8. And thou shalt number 7 Sabbaths of years unto thee, 7 times 7 years, and the space of 7 Sabbaths of years shall be unto thee 49 years. Then shalt thou cause the trumpet of the Jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month. In the Day of Atonement shalt ye make the trumpet sound throughout all your land. And ye shall hallow the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto all the inhabitants thereof. It shall be a jubilee unto you, and ye shall return every man unto his possession, and ye shall return every man unto his family. Did you notice in verse number 10, where the Word of God says, proclaim liberty throughout all the land and all the inhabitants thereof. Do you know where that scripture is written? On the Liberty Bell. The Liberty Bell. So the symbol of our freedom just up the street, up 95 in Philadelphia. That scripture, Leviticus 25:10, is written thereon. And who'd have thought that it's talking about the year of Jubilee? So let's this morning look at this Old Testament celebration and see how it relates to us and to our celebration here in our 50th year. Let's pray. Father, thank you this morning for the time to share the word. Thank you for the beautiful music, touching music, soul-stirring music that has prepared our hearts now. As we look at this passage of scripture in the Old Testament, my prayer today is that we will appreciate the 50 years, the Jubilee celebration here at our church. I wish everybody could be back. I wish, Lord, everybody, was sitting in the pews as they once were. But we're going to celebrate whether we're here or whether we're online. And I just pray, Lord, that this would be a grand day and a grand month and a grand year, Lord, as we look back at the blessings of 50 years. We pray your blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. If you ever notice in the Bible, God uses certain numbers for a significance. I was thinking about this. You know, think about the number 40. 10 years ago, we celebrated, of course, our 40th anniversary. And the number 40 has really a lot of significance in the Bible. For example, how many days did it rain on the earth during the flood? 40 days, 40 nights. How many days was Jesus in the wilderness praying and fasting? 40 days and 40 nights. How many days was Moses up on the mountain receiving the law? 40 days, 40 nights. How many years did the Israelites wander in the wilderness? 40 years. And on it goes. There's many other, 40-year significances in the Bible. It seems like the 40-year was kind of a time of trial, kind of a time of testing. And it seems as though that the 40 years had that sort of significance. But then we get to 50, and there's not a lot in the Bible about 50, except for this mysterious year of Jubilee. So let's kind of look back, and let's see what this year of Jubilee is all about. We'll see what it meant in the Bible in biblical days to the Israelites and what it means today for us. Several things about this Jubilee. We're not going to get to our first point yet. I'm going to kind of give you a background before we start hitting our points this morning. But the history of the Jubilee is, first off, it starts with Sabbath year's rest. Whenever God started the world, in 6 days he created everything. What did he do on the seventh day? He rested. He called it a Sabbath, a rest, Sabbath rest. Well, when Israel was going to march into the Promised Land, Leviticus was written when they were in the wilderness. They escaped Egypt. They're in the wilderness. They're going towards the Promised Land. He said, when you get in the Promised Land, you have your own land. Here's how things are going to go. You are going to work your land for 6 years. 6 years, you'll work your land, your vineyards, and you'll produce crops. And then you're going to take a year off. No planting, no harvesting, no working. You got a year off. That's sometimes you hear today people are taking a sabbatical, and that comes from, they'll take a time period off, whether it's 6 months or a year or whatever, and that comes kind of from a biblical principle here. So you had then every 7 years you're supposed to take a year off. Well, then he said take 7 sabbatical years. That would be 49 years. So on the 49th year, you take that year off. And then the next year is the 50th year. You're going to take that year off also. So on the 49th and 50th year, you would take 2 years off, no planning. And we'll see some of the things that went on during that time also. And you would have a year of Jubilee. During that time, in verse number 14, it says that you would blow the trumpet. And verse number 4, they would blow a trumpet on the 7th day of the 10th day of the 7th month, which would be the Day of Atonement. And so the blowing of the trumpet became known as the Jubilee. Now, trumpet back in those days, not like you think today, a brass instrument. What did they use for a trumpet? A ram's horn. And if you ever go to Israel, they sell you ram's horns. You say, Pastor, did you ever get one? No, they were too expensive. And I never could work somebody down on a deal, so I never went away with a ram's horn. And I'm like, what am I going to do with it? I'm not going to go, blow the horn every day. Time for church. We should do that.
They'd get the ram's horn, you know, and year of Jubilee, we're taking a year off. Doesn't that sound wonderful? How many would love to take a year off? How many would love to take 2 years off in a row? Some of you have been off for a long time, but you know, wouldn't you like to have a year of Jubilee? Well, that's what they were supposed to do. Look at verse number 10. It says, and you shall hallow the 50th year. It's a holy year. It's a sacred year. It's a special year. You take off. You don't do anything. It's like the Sabbath, only an entire year you are to make it holy. And then what else are you supposed to do? Proclaim liberty throughout the land. Everybody's free. What do you mean? So if you were a slave, you were set free. If you owe debts, you were set free. If someone had someone had to take your property because of debts, your property was returned back to you. And so now what happened? They're celebrating. Now, of course, those who had to give land up, that wasn't much of a celebration for them. Those who had to cancel debts, maybe wasn't a celebration for them. But God said, I want every 50 years, I want to wipe out the debts. I want everybody to return back to their lands. I want everything to be how it should be. I don't want anybody that is oppressed anymore. And we're going to celebrate. We're going to take a year off. And this was God's plan for that. Verse number 10, they would release debts. And verse number 12, for it is a year of Jubilee. It shall be holy unto you. You shall eat the increase thereof of the field. Well, how are you going to eat the increase of the field if you haven't grown anything for 2 years? Well, we'll get into that later on at the very end, actually. Now, so you get an idea what the year of Jubilee is, right? Unfortunately, Israel neglected their Sabbath years. Unfortunately, Israel neglected years of Jubilee. Do you remember when Israel went into captivity to the Babylonians, the southern kingdom of Judah? Nebuchadnezzar came in and took them captivity. How many years did they go into captivity? 70 years. Do you know why God chose 70 years? Because they missed 70 sabbatical years. And God said, you didn't listen to me. Every 7 years, they kept working. They ignored the Sabbath years. They ignored the years of Jubilee. And so when it came to judge Israel, God said, hey, I'm going to remind you, you get to rest 70 years in Babylon now because you didn't take care of the 70 years. 70 years of Sabbath you neglected. That's 490 years of Israel's history. They ignored this passage of Scripture that we just read here today. Now, so what does year of Jubilee mean to us? Well, 50 years. Hey, it's in the Bible. We have to come up with something on 50 years, right? So what is a year of Jubilee? Well, let me give you a few things this morning. I think we can appreciate what the year of Jubilee means here in our church. Number one, what did the year of Jubilee mean? It meant that you rest in the Lord. You rest in the Lord. And I know some of you are resting right now in Jesus. Wake up. Some of you online, listen. I've watched me online. I've dozed off while I'm watching me online. When we didn't have Sunday nights here, but I would pre-record Sunday nights, and we would sit home and say, okay, let's watch Sunday nights. And I'd wake up, oh, what happened? What happened? Of course, I know what the sermon was all about. But we're going to rest in the Lord. When God rested on the seventh day, he worked 6 days, took a day off. Sabbath. Israel. You're now commanded every seventh day, on the seventh day, take off. Now, Israel still, if you go to Israel, which we've been many times, Brother Pat was there also a couple times, and you go there on the Sabbath, and that's sunset on Friday night through sunset on Saturday night. That is their Sabbath. On Friday nights, they'll have usually a meal prepared. They don't prepare it themselves. They'll go to a hotel, a restaurant, or they'll have a meal already prepared. And the Orthodox Jews and the ones who follow that still do the Sabbath rest. If you go into a hotel, they'll have what they call Shabbat. Shabbat is Sabbath. The Shabbat elevators. And you're like this. You don't press any buttons. And they just stop at every floor. Because if you press the button, what are you doing? You're working. So they take it really to some extremes, to be honest. So... But Sabbath became a very important thing. Now, where the Israelites honored the Sabbath day, they did not honor the Sabbath year. where they took that one day off a week. They didn't take a year off every seventh. And so, what was God saying? God's saying that I want you to take a year off. I want you to take a year off. I want you to rest. You ever think about this? We rest one third, anywhere from one fourth to one third of our life. Do you know that? If you have 24 hours a day, if you sleep 6 hours, it's one fourth your day. You sleep 8 hours, which is recommended, 6 to 8 hours. You realize one third of your day, you're unconscious. What are you doing? You're resting. You know why? Because we can't keep going on and on and on without resting. You can't do it. You're exhausted. You're physically worn out. Your body was made to rest. Your body was made to go home after a day's work, lay down, go to sleep, rest, wake up, feel refreshed, and go on for the next day. That's how God created us. And so, lest you think that for some reason you don't need enough sleep, or you think that somehow, some way, you know, you're going to accomplish all these different things on very little sleep and a lot of coffee, that's not good. God designed us to work and rest. Work, rest, work, rest. Well, God said, look, you've worked 6 years. Now I want you to take a year off. I want you to rest for an entire year. And so he's teaching them the principle of rest. Look at some of these scriptures here today. Psalm 37, verse 7 says, rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Do you know in our life, we're busy, we're hurried, we have problems and burdens and schedules and stresses and anxiety and suffering and all these different things. And there comes a point in our life where we just need to learn how to rest in the Lord. Nothing wrong with resting in the Lord. Doesn't mean you're lazy. You know, when we were in our younger days in college and all that, you know, bless God, we're going to work. We're going to go. We're going to keep going. We're never going to quit. We're gonna, you know, you're a sluggard if you're sleeping. You're no good, you know. And I had to learn a long time ago, man, there's a lot of burned out people from that. And God said, I don't want you burned out. You're in a marathon, not a sprint. And so in order for you to reach the end and to do all that God's told you to do, there's going to be days where you're going to have to rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Look at Psalm 46, verse 10. Be still and know that I'm God. Just stop. Just be still. Rest in the Lord. You know, we live in such a busy world. I mean, people working jobs and second jobs. And then, of course, you have to be on social media. And you have to have movies. And you have to have music. And you have to have video games. And you have to have sports. And you have to have. And your mind is racing and going on. And we have so many things in our hearts and our minds and our activities. And we just never stop to get to know who God is. And God says, you know, you're a Jubilee. You're going to take a whole year off and you're going to rest. You're going to get to know me that year. You're going to get to pray more. You're not going to be so busy and worn out that you can't meet me every day and you can't fellowship with me every day. And you're going to learn how to rest for an entire year because you know what? After you rest, you're more productive. And so be still, know that I'm God. Even the psalmist in the great Psalm 23, verse 2 and 3, it says, he maketh me. He makes me lie down. He makes me lie down. Some of you that had COVID, you know what that verse is all about, right? He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. Or sometimes God says, you know, I need you just to slow down and stop. He restoreth my soul. I love that verse. He restores my soul. So after you rest, what happens? You're restored. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And so there comes a restoration. There comes now a renewal. There comes to revigorate ourselves and our spirit and our mind so that you can be more productive, so that you can reach more people for Jesus, so that you can keep on serving the Lord. And so God says, listen, if I'm going to let you lay down sometimes. I want you to rest. I want you to take it easy. I want you to appreciate who I am. You need to learn how to rest. There's nothing better than taking a good night's sleep after a long day of hard work, is there not? There's not like even in the middle of the day when you're all worn out and you just need to take a little power nap there. Just to rest. But you know, we need to not only find rest for our bodies, but we need to find rest for our mind and and rest for our soul. Rest for our soul. Our souls are in turmoil. Our souls are in confusion. Our souls are in anguish. Our souls are in grief. Our souls at times go through things that tax our souls. And there comes a time in our life where we have to learn how to rest in Him to find relief. He restores my soul. Look at Jesus said in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 and 29. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest in your souls. Even Jesus knew what it was all about to rest. Even Jesus knew what it was about to say, come unto me. You're tired. You're worn out. You're burdened. You're messed up. You're worried. You're afraid. You have anxiety. You have fears. You have problems. You have pain. You have suffering. You have sickness. You have a pandemic. You have all these things going on. He said, you need to learn how to come to me, and I'll give you rest. If you'll come to me, you'll find rest. And so let me give you three statements under this. Number one, how do you find rest? Learn to stop and wait on God. Just learn to stop, slow down, wait on God. Wait on God. When you pray, wait on God. When you read the Word of God, wait on Him to respond. When you're so worried, just stop. Just wait on God. Let Him move. Let Him work. Let Him restore your soul. Let Him mount you up with wings of eagles so you can keep on running. But you have to get alone with God sometimes. Number two, claim promises on rest. Lord, I need rest. Lord, I need help. I need strength. I need your grace. I see these promises in the Word of God. I'm claiming, Jesus, here I come. You said, if I come to you, that I will find rest. If I learn of you and see what you're all about, I will find rest. If I sit still, Lord, you promised me that you'd give rest in my soul. Rest is a very important thing in our life. And the last thing, release all your burdens on the Lord. Just release everything to Him. Just don't hang on to things. Don't hang on to everything. You know, we were not made to be very strong people. In fact, we're kind of weaklings in a lot of ways. And that's where God comes in. Because when I am weak, He is strong. And so I can't carry all my burdens. But you know, He said, take my yoke upon me. Meaning, you yoke up with me, I'll help you carry the burdens. 1 Peter 5, 7 says this, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. Just kind of picture yourself, Lord, here's all my burdens, all my problems, all my everything, and I'm putting it in a big box, and I'm casting it at you, Lord, and it's all yours. I don't want it back anymore. You see, find rest in your soul. Now, you can go on living your harried life, living your busy life, living your workaholic life. And by the way, some people take great pride in being a workaholic, and sometimes that is not a healthy, physically or mentally or spiritually. Because when you work all the time, something is getting left out. Your family's getting left out, your church is getting left out, God's getting left out. So I know some people take great pride, and I'm a workaholic, you know, work, you know, 80 hours a week, you know. I know some of you have to, but you know, you're not going to make it spiritually after a while. You have to learn how to find rest in your soul. And so what's a year of Jubilee? Take a year off, people. So guess what? This year, you're all off. That doesn't mean you're off from church. Seems like it for some people. But it's a symbol of finding rest in the Lord. What's the second thing about the year of Jubilee? It's all about reliance on the Lord. Reliance on the Lord. So as I rest in the Lord, I take a year off. But wait a minute, if I take a year off, how are we going to eat? How are we going to have crops? How are we going to have food? How are we going to live if we take a year off? And by the way, that's why the Israelites didn't take a year off. They couldn't trust. They couldn't rely on God. You see, in their minds, they're thinking, well, we have our families to feed. We have businesses. There's no way we can do this if we take an entire year off. But wait a minute, if they look back in their history and they saw how manna came down from heaven, how many days did manna come down from heaven? 6 days. The seventh day, no manna came. Did that mean you starved on the seventh day? No. What happened on the sixth day? You got a double portion. You got a double portion. Do you think maybe God could have given them a double portion of crops on the sixth year that would have taken care of the seventh year? Isn't that what God did in Egypt when there were 7 years of plenteous, followed by 7 years of famine? The 7 years in which God allowed them to have a lot took over for the 7 years of leanness. And so God told Israel, here's what I want you to do. I want you to take 2 years off now. The sabbatical year and then the year of Jubilee, the 49th and 50th year. 2 years. 2 years you're going to have to take off. That's really trusting God, isn't it? It'd be like some of us saying, well, we're going to retire. We're going to quit our jobs or resign, and for 2 years we don't have a job. Man, that's pretty scary, isn't it? Pretty undaunting to think that you have no income. But you know what? If God told them to do that, would God not take care of them? Would God? So it was a test. Can you obey me? Can you trust me? Can you rely on me? Can you live by faith? Folks, we've been in church 50 years. We've been called to walk by faith, not by sight. We've been called to rely on God for 50 years. From the very first pastor to the second to me, the three pastors and all the people that have served this church over these past many years, we've all had to come to the point in our life where we just simply say, we don't know how the bills are going to be paid, but we're going to trust God. We don't know. We're going to build buildings and have programs and hire staff, but we don't know for sure any guarantee. You know, when I sit down with our men, our deacons, and we look over the budget for the next year, we're just putting numbers out there. We have no guarantee any of those offerings are going to come in. And we talk about it. We pray. We say, Lord, we don't know what next year is going to hold, but this is our budget, and this is what we'd like to do, and this is our plan, and we're going to trust you that you're going to provide the needs. It's walking by faith. You see, every family, every person, every church needs to learn how to rely on the Lord. And the year of Jubilee was a year in which everybody every day had to say, okay, Lord, we're just trusting you. We're relying on you. Now, three things. Number one, what is a reminder of? It's a reminder of our stewardship. Do you know what stewardship is? Stewardship goes something like this. God owns everything, and I manage what he gives me. And so, therefore, who owned the land in Israel? God owned the land. Who farmed the land? The Israelites. So they were to be good stewards of what God gave them. Who owns a church? God. Who owns your house and your money and your properties? God owns it all. He owns everything. You know what you are? You know, we came in this world with nothing. What are we going to leave this world with? Nothing. So we just manage what God gives us in the years that God gives us. And so it is a reminder of our stewardship. And if God says, take a year off, we say, Lord, you're under control. This is your land. This is your ministry. This is what you want. And so it is a reminder that I just manage. It's not mine. It's not mine. It'd be good for us to remember that in our lives, in our families, in our churches. That we are, listen, the church is not about us. Jesus said, I will build upon this rock, I will build my church. Not the pastor's church, not your church, but his church. We're just managers of what he's given us. And so it's a reminder of our stewardship. Secondly, it's a reminder of his faithfulness. It's a reminder of his faithfulness. Can God supply our needs? Can he take care of you for 50 years? Can he take care of your life? It's a reminder. Listen, this is what God is all about. Is he faithful? I love songs about faithfulness. I love songs that talk about our theme up here, 50 years of faithfulness. By the way, faithfulness goes both ways. God's always faithful to us, and we have to be faithful to him.
It's a reminder of His faithfulness. Can God supply our needs? Listen to these verses. Psalm 23, verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Sounds like He's taking care of everything, right? Psalm 37, verse 25. This is my new verse now. I've been young, and now I'm old. And yet I've not seen the righteous forsaken, nor a seed begging bread. How many can relate to that? You've been young, you're old now, and you've never had to beg bread, or you've never had to see the righteous forsaken, or a seed begging bread. Sounds like God's going to take care of us, doesn't He? He's faithful. He's faithful. Philippians 4:19. But my God shall supply all your need according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. It is a reminder of our faithfulness. 35 years ago, we came to Concord Baptist Church. I was a young man. I think I was about 10 years old. I felt like I was 10. I was a young man. I was serving another church in Delaware. The church contacted me about coming and candidating. I went to the pastor that I was with at that time, and I told him about the situation. He knew the church, he knew the pastor. And I said, what do you think? He says, I don't recommend you to go. I said, why not? He said, you're a young man. They have a lot of debt. I don't want to see you go there and fail. And I said, well, you know. He said, but you pray and fast about it, and you do what God wants to do. So I took that part of his advice. And we just felt like if this was God's will, that maybe God could still come through and take care of everything. We came. We had several mortgages, first mortgage, second mortgage, and a personal loan to somebody. I was just dumb and young. I didn't know any different. I said, well, you know, God's just going to take care of this. And we started winning people to Christ and baptizing people, started up a bus ministry or got it going more, and started one up and started the various programs and just tried to reach people for the Lord. And next thing a couple years have gone by, and, you know, one debt's paid off, and a few more years go by, and another debt's paid off, and finally, a number of years later, guess what? We're out of debt. God's faithful. And there was no one person that came and gave us a great sum of money or some big endowment. It was just faithful people giving. And God was faithful. When I first came, we had no money to improve anything about our church. I mean, it was like every week we paid the salary, and that was about it. And when I came here, we had many that were here back in the day. We had an old carpet, old green carpet. They loved green. They had green carpet here. And every seam was split, and so they got green duct tape, and they put duct tape. We called it the tape ministry. There was tape everywhere, you know. I walked in, I was like, what is this place? And by the way, this is no slam against anybody before. They just had money. You know, you're just trying to pay bills. You don't have money for carpet. You know how it is. Sometimes in your house, you look at your green carpet, it's all taped up too, don't you? And so we just said, we have to get a new carpet here. So we took up an offering, and we scraped together some money. And long story short, we ended up getting a carpet for free. And then we needed buses, and we ended up getting a bus for free and another one for $600. Of course, they didn't last that long, but at least they got going rolling for a while. And we start seeing God giving answers and being faithful. You know, you don't need to have a lot of money as long as you have the God who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. And so God said, listen, you're going to take a year off. You're going to have to trust me. Some of you, maybe in your retirement years, maybe you're in between jobs, maybe financially things are tight, and you question, I can't tithe. You can't afford not to tithe. I can't give the missions. How about me? Well, how about you? How about the work of God? Did you ever not read in the Word of God that as we give, He gives back? Do you ever read how that whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap? And so you just keep giving, and you keep doing what God wants you to do, and all of a sudden, you know what? You make it. And that's what God wanted the people to learn on the year of Jubilee. You have to learn how to trust me an entire year and then an entire second year that I'm going to take care of your needs. And then the third aspect is a reminder of our future. Who holds our future? God holds our future. What will happen in our future? I have no idea. I'm not a fortune teller. And the fortune tellers don't know either.
I have no idea what the future is going to hold. Will we get sick? Will we become infirmed? What will happen? We don't know. How many could have predicted several years ago that our country and our world would change tremendously because of a little virus? You don't know the future. None of us know the future. But we know the God who holds the future. And so if we've been always relying on God and we've seen Him work, we have hope for the future. We know He's going to keep doing it. We know He's going to keep on the same program. He's going to keep on supplying our needs no matter what happens, because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Third thing your Jubilee was all about, it was release from debt. Release from debt. How many wish all your credit cards and your mortgages and everything was paid off and you were debt free? Would you raise your hand right now? Every hand should be up right now. God bless you. Have you ever paid off a credit card? Like you kept paying like the minimum. By the way, that's a bad thing to do. You know that? You pay a lot of interest. But that's all you, maybe you're young, you don't know any different, you know, whatever. You remember when you took out that 30-year mortgage, you think like you're never going to pay this house off? Like the first 20 years, all you're doing is paying interest and very little principal. Did you ever get to the point where you paid off that credit card, you paid off your car, you paid off your house? You know how good it felt? Hey, I'm ready to get another car. Hey, I'm ready to get another house now. Get back in debt again, amen? Well, every year, every Jubilee, in Leviticus 25, verse number 10, it says, "And you shall hallow the 50th year and proclaim liberty throughout all the land unto the inhabitants thereof. It shall be a jubilee unto you, and you shall return every man unto his possession," give back everything that once belonged to him, his land, his property, his animals, "and you shall return every man to his family." No more slavery, no more slaves. Everybody gets set free. Nobody's under bondage anymore. Look at verse 13. "In the year of Jubilee, you shall return every man unto his possession." So now, lest you think, oh, you know, people just look forward to Jubilee so they don't have to pay their bills. And we don't have time to get into it, but if you study this passage out, usually what they do is if there was 5 years before Jubilee and they had to borrow money, they would make it work out so that they could pay it within that 5 years. Say to know anybody. So this is not people living recklessly and people just getting in debt and worrying, well, your Jubilee's coming up, doesn't matter. You know, it's like kind of somebody that's dying and has a credit card. Well, don't matter, I'll be dead pretty soon. I'm going to jack up all my credit cards, you know? It's not being irresponsible. It just meant that, listen, every 50 years, God said, let's press the reset button. I don't want anybody in debt anymore. I don't want anybody in slavery anymore. I don't want anybody not free anymore. Let's proclaim liberty. Everybody's set free. Everybody's back to the way it was. Nobody's oppressed anymore. And God is saying, listen, I want everybody to enjoy their life. I don't want you to be under the debt, the oppression, slavery. I don't want these things to destroy you for an entire lifetime. So at least every 50 years, God said, I'm going to give you a break, and we're releasing all debts. They're all canceled. Well, sounds pretty good, doesn't it? Now, we know that we can't do that in our country. We know that you know, these things do not apply to our modern-day Christianity. But how does this apply to us? Let's think about this. Do you owe a debt to God? The Bible says that we are all sinners. Romans chapter 6, verse 23 says this, "The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." What's this saying about? That God has released us from a debt. You know what it's called? Redemption. God has released us from a debt. We owe a debt we cannot pay. He paid a debt He did not owe. As sinners, we're debtors before God. Do you understand that? You know what the debt we owe before God? You know what is the final result of our sin? It's death. Not only death physically, but death spiritually in a place called hell, separation from God from all eternity. And if we live in our sin, someday we have to pay that debt. Now, we pay it by dying physically, but thank God we don't have to pay that debt spiritually by dying a second time. That's called redemption. So that means somebody had to pay our debts. Jesus paid it all. You think I could get a job singing with you guys? All to Him I owe. I'm auditioning. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. You're not the only one that can sing, Pat. Now, I know you do it a lot better. You remember the couple times we sang with you? That was exciting. After I watched, I say, I'm not going to do that anymore. But anyhow. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for dying for our sins. Thank you for releasing our debt. We don't owe you anything now. We stand before God redeemed. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. We've been set free. Set free. Romans 8:2 says this, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 20, for you are bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and your spirit, which are God's. I belong to Him. He belongs to me. He purchased me on the cross. The day that I got saved, I became His and He became mine. My debt was free, set free. Oh, I'll never forget the day that I got up off my knees. I told you last week, it was October 10th, which was last Sunday. And it was 1976, 5 years after this church started, when I got saved. And when I got up off my knees, I'll never forget. Now, I tell people, salvation is not about feeling, but that day I felt something. I felt good. I felt cleansed. I felt forgiven. I felt as though my sins were all washed away. If you've ever seen or read Pilgrim's Progress, you know when Pilgrim's at the foot of the cross and he's been carrying this big sack on his back the whole time. And when he gets saved, the sack drops off and it rolls down a hill. I'm saying today, what's Jubilee? You've been set free. It was a picture of someday when Jesus would come and die on a cross and pay our sin debt. And now we've been set free. We no longer are debtors. We no longer are under the condemnation of sin. We're no longer condemned to hell. We've been set free by the blood of Jesus. Aren't you glad for redemption? Galatians 5:1 says this. Galatians 5:1, stand fast therefore in the liberty, freedom, wherewith Christ hath made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. It means you've been set free. Don't go back into slavery again. Don't go back into your old sinful life again. You've been set free. Live like a free person. You've been set free. What else does this mean? Second aspect. God has not only released us from our debts, that means we need to release others. That's called forgiveness. If God could release us from our debts, cannot we release others from their debts that they owe us? Forgive us our debtors as God has forgiven us. What does that mean? That meant that the people of Israel, if someone owed them something on the year of Jubilee, they had to say, okay, even though you owe me money, it's forgiven. Even though I have your land and you've been paying me off, it has to return to you. Do you understand what it took to return debts or cancel debts? Do you know what it took for them to say, you no longer owe me anything, you're set free? It took grace on their part to set people free from their debts. If you've been set free, go out and set other people free. That means forget about your grudges and your heartaches and your bitterness against people. And, well, you don't understand how I grew up, and you don't understand what that person did to me, and you don't understand the abuse that I've been through. Listen, I know some of you have suffered. I know that you have your terrible stories. I know that there are situations in life that seem unbearable and unforgivable, but you have two choices, either to hang on to things and live in that and have the bitterness that comes from it and have all the issues that come with unforgiveness, or you can just release it and let it go and say, Lord, just like the year of Jubilee, I'm letting it go. I'm no longer holding those people to debt. My parents may have wronged me. My family may have wronged me. A spouse may have wronged me. My children may have wronged me. A job may have wronged me. People at my work may have wronged me. Church members may have wronged me. But thank God I've been released, and I'm going to release also all debts. Do you know what it is to live in freedom? But see, when you live in unforgiveness, you're living in bondage. And so look at this passage of Scripture in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32, and be kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you.
Peter came to Jesus one day and he said, Lord, how many times should I forgive my brother? How about seven times? I can imagine the Lord kind of laughing at him. How about 70 times seven instead? Jesus gave a parable one time about a man that owed a king much money and he could not pay it back. And so the man was taken and he was going to be thrown in jail, and he begged for mercy and he received mercy and he was forgiven of his great debt. And he went out shortly thereafter and he found somebody, a friend of his, that owed him just a little bit of money, and he said, I want it back. And a guy said, I don't have any. Threw him in jail. The master came back to that man and said, listen, you're going to go to jail now because you were forgiven and you couldn't forgive somebody else. And so let's learn to forgive. You'll be like Jesus. The last thing the year Jubilee meant, in keeping with the R theme today, if you notice that, rejoicing in the Lord. We're just going to rejoice in the Lord. Blow the trumpet. Time for celebration. Get the ram's horn out. Rejoice. What are we going to rejoice in? Number one, we're going to rejoice in God's blessings. Now, the question we posed earlier in the message was, how can you live? If you have the 49th year, that's the seventh Sabbath, you have the 49th year off. Then you have the 50th year after that year, Jubilee, that's 2 years. So how are you going to live for 2 years without planting any crops, harvesting anything? How are you going to make it for 2 years? Notice what it says here. In Leviticus chapter 25, verse 19, it says, and the land shall yield her fruit, and you shall eat your fill and dwell therein. And you shall say, what shall we eat the seventh year? Behold, we shall not sow nor gather in our increase. Then I will command my blessing upon you in the sixth year, and it shall bring forth fruit for 3 years. God said, if you trust me on that 48th year, I'm going to give you enough for 3 years. That covers the 49th, 50th, and that gives you a bonus year. Well, actually, probably that year. But in essence, God said, I'm going to take care of you. And so we rejoice. We rejoice in God's provision. We rejoice in His care. We rejoice. He's Jehovah Jireh, God our provider. He's El Shaddai, my supplier. He's Jehovah Rapha, my healer. He's Jehovah Nisi, my banner over me. He's Jehovah Shalom. He's my peace. When Moses said, who shall I say that you are? Just say, I am sent you. Because you know what? I am sums it all up. I'm everything. I'm going to give you everything. And we rejoice in who God is and His blessings. Secondly, and under that, I love this Psalm 23, verse 6. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. What's going to follow me? The blessings of God every day. We rejoice. Oh, but you don't understand. I don't feel good today. Rejoice. Did the Bible say rejoice when you feel good, or rejoice in the Lord always? Always. Because God is good every day. God is wonderful every day. Listen, through the aches, the pains, the sorrow, the death, the shadows of death, everything, we still rejoice. Because you know why? It's Jubilee. Did that mean nobody died that year? Yeah, people died. Did that mean people never got sick? Yeah, they got sick that year. Did they have problems? Yes. But we still rejoice. 50 years later, we're still saying, thank you, Lord. Sometimes I have to keep reminding myself, just rejoice, because sometimes I don't see people, and sometimes people have gone astray, or sometimes they don't come back to church, or, you know, and don't have this ministry anymore, and can't do that anymore, and can't visit anymore, and I just have to shake myself and say, stop it, be quiet. Just rejoice in the blessings of God. Rejoice in His blessings. Number two, rejoice in His love. It's a reminder how much God loves us. It's a reminder how much He cares for us. It's a reminder how much He protects us and cares for us and meets our every need. And lastly, rejoice in our heavenly home. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. You see, folks, we're just pilgrims. We're journeying through this land. Someday, we're going to be in our real home. This world will end someday. The pain, the suffering, everything. And you know what? Every day we can rejoice that there's a mansion prepared for me. There is a Savior who's waiting for me to welcome me. There are streets of gold. There are the saints of God. There is this heaven
that we can't ever imagine what it's all about. But thank God we're going to go there because of Jesus. In a year of Jubilee, we just keep celebrating. And we say, Lord, we thank you for what you've given us here. But we really thank you for what's going to happen someday. Our eternal rest. And so, when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the star, we've no less days to sing his praise than when we first began. See, folks, the year of Jubilee is pretty special. Unfortunately, Israel never celebrated the way they should have. Think of all those years they could have had rest in the Lord. Think of all those years they could have been relying on the Lord, trusting God. Think of those years they could have been released from debt. Think of those years they could have been rejoicing. May I encourage you and challenge you to not only make this year the year of Jubilee, but what do you say next year at number 51, we make that year the year of Jubilee also? And then we go to 52, and we just say every year is going to be a year of Jubilee. The year of Jubilee, that's what it's all about. Now you know, all right? Let's pray. Father, thank you this morning for the time to share the word. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed this morning. How many know for sure you're saved and on your way to heaven? Would you raise your hands? You're saved. You're on your way to heaven. Thank you. God bless you. How many would say this morning, I'm not really sure, but I want to be saved? How many this morning? Just slip a hand up. I'm not sure I'm saved. Not sure I'm on my way to heaven, but I want to know for sure. Anybody? How about those that are watching online? Can you raise your hand there at your house and just say, yeah, I'm not sure I'm saved? If you're not saved today, you really can't celebrate the way you should because you've not been released from your debts. But if you come to Jesus, you'll be released from your debts. You'll be saved. You'll find redemption. If you're not saved, pray this with me right now, will you? Dear Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. I know that Christ, you died for me, and I call on you to be my Savior. Save me. Take me to heaven. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed this morning. I'm going to say, Pastor, I'm going to take the challenge. I'm going to learn how to rest in the Lord. I'm troubled in my soul. I worry. I live in fear at times. I have issues. And I'm going to just try to learn how to rest and spend more time in the Lord. Would you raise your hand this morning? You need to learn to rest more. Let's be honest. Let's slip our hand up before the Lord and say, Lord, show me how that I may find rest in you. How many this morning, sometimes you struggle with your faith and you can't rely on the Lord? You say, I've been reminded, I just got to trust God. I got to rely on the Lord, just like they had to rely for 2 years. How many say, God spoke to my heart about relying on Him more? Would you raise your hand before Him today? I got to learn how to trust Him. I got to learn how to just trust Him. He's in control. And then how many, you've been released from your debt, but you've been holding on to the debt of others. You haven't found, given, granted forgiveness. Did God speak to your heart and say, could you forgive? You say, well, I'm going to wait for that person to ask me to forgive. No, it doesn't work that way. You just forgive. How many this morning, God's touched you about something that you need to just grant forgiveness and God spoke to your heart about it? Would you raise your hand this morning? Would you raise your hand this morning and say, God spoke to me about forgiveness? And then lastly, how many say, I need to just rejoice. Good days, bad days, it doesn't matter. God is wonderful. He's my Savior. He loves me. He's my Father. How many, we need to rejoice more in the Lord. Father, thank you today for this time to share this word. Bless now our time in which we'll spend reflecting upon this message. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have the McCluskeys come at this time. They're going to sing a song. This will kind of be our invitation. Would you stand, please, as you listen to them? I want you to bow your heads. They're going to sing a song today. I want you to think about this year of Jubilee. And I want you to proclaim it in your life. I want you to say, I want you to grab a hold of this concept and allow it to permeate your heart and your mind. I want to ask our ushers also to come forward at this time. Likewise, as they're singing, as you're thinking, we're going to take them an offering. So I know, hope you can do all those things together, okay? And we want you to give today. This is an offering for the McCluskeys. We want them to feel taken care of. I'm going to pray. We're going to start the offering. Do you have the offering plates? It does help if you have plates, guys. Put them in your pockets, right?
Alrighty, let's pray and we'll get that all sorted out. Father, thank you today for this time to share the word. Thank you for this offering we're about to receive. Thank you for the McCluskeys as they come sing for us. I pray, Lord, it would be a blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.